Laugh a bit, drink a bit, love a bit more. You can supply our needs. Think a bit, shop a bit, what's it all for? That's your Eurasian creed. Sailors with sentimental hearts who love and sail away. When the dawn is gray, look at you and say, half-caste woman, living a life apart, where did your story begin? Half-caste woman, have you a secret heart waiting for someone to win? Were you born of some queer magic in your shimmering gown? Is there something strange and tragic deep, deep down? Half-caste woman, what are your slanting eyes hoping and waiting to see? Scanning the far horizon, wondering what the end will be. Down along the river, the sky is a quiver, for dawn is beginning to break. Hear the sirens wailing, some big ship is sailing and losing your dreams in its wake. Why should you remember the things that are past, moments so swiftly gone? Why worry, for the Lord knows life goes on. Go to bed in daylight, try to sleep in vain. Get up in the evening, work begins again. Tinker, tailor, soldier, sailor, rich man, poor man, beggar man, thief, questioning the same refrain. Half-caste woman, living a life apart, where did your story begin? Half-caste woman, have you a secret heart waiting for someone to win? Were you born of some queer magic in your shimmering gown? Is there something strange and tragic deep, deep down? Half-caste woman, what are your slanting eyes waiting and hoping to see? Scanning the far horizon, wondering what the end will be.
My family has traditions. I've heard them 1,000 times. My relatives were not excessively bright. They loved to go off on missions to rather peculiar climes and lead the wretched heathen to the light. A few of them got beaten up. In course of these rampages, my great-aunt Maud got eaten up while singing Rock of Ages. These family expeditions admittedly are a bore, but there is just one uncle that I positively adore. Poor Uncle Harry wanted to be a missionary, so he took a ship and sailed away. This visionary, hotly pursued by dear Aunt Mary, found the South Sea island which to stay. The natives greeted them kindly and invited them to dine on yams and clams and human hams and vintage coconut wine, the taste of which was filthy, but the after effects divine. Poor Uncle Harry got a bit gay and longed to tarry. This Aunt Mary couldn't quite allow. She lectured him severely on a number of church affairs, but when she'd gone to bed, he made her get away down the stairs, for he longed to find the answer to a few of the maiden's prayers. Uncle Harry's not a missionary now. Poor Uncle Harry, after a chat with dear Aunt Mary, thought the time had come to make a row. He lined up all the older girls in one of the local sheds, And while he was reviving them and tearing himself to shreds, they took their mother hubbards off and tied them around their heads. Uncle Harry's not a missionary now. He's awfully happy, but he's certainly not a missionary now. Now, Uncle was just a seeker, a dreamer sincerely blessed of this. There couldn't be a shadow of doubt. The fact that his flesh was weaker than even Aunt Mary guessed took even her some time to figure out. In all those languid latitudes, the atmosphere's exotic. To take up moral attitudes would be too idiotic. Though nobody could be meeker than Uncle had been before, I'll bet today he's giving way at practically every pore. Poor Uncle Harry, having become a missionary, found the natives' morals rather crude. He and Aunt Mary swiftly imposed an arbitrary ban upon them shopping in the nude. Now, they all considered this silly, and they didn't take it well. They burnt his boots and several suits and wrecked the mission hotel. They also burnt his Macintosh, which made it disgusting smell. Poor Uncle Harry, after some words with dear Aunt Mary, called upon the chiefs for a powwow. Now, they didn't brandish knives at him. They really were awfully sweet. They made concerted dives at him and offered him things to eat. But when they threw their wives at him, he had to admit defeat. Uncle Harry's not a missionary now. Poor dear Aunt Mary, though it was revolutionary, thought her time had come to take a bow. For Uncle Harry looked at her, in whom he had placed his trust. His very last illusion broke and crumbled away to dust. For she placed a flower behind her ear and frankly exposed her bust. Uncle Harry's not a missionary now. He's left the island, but he's certainly not a missionary now. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I've had a special request tonight to sing you a song that I wrote many years ago that I hope some of you may remember. It's called A Room with a View. A room with a view and you, and no one to flurry us, no one to hurry us through this dream we found. We'll gaze at the sky and try to get what it's all about, then we will figure out the world is round. We'll be as happy and contented as birds upon a tree, high above the mountains and seas. We'll build and we'll do, and sorrow will never come, or will it ever come true? Cherishing through the perishing winter nights and days, a funny little phrase that means such a lot to me that you've got to be with me heart and soul, for on you the whole thing leans. Come with me and leave behind the noisy crowds. Sunlight shines for us above the clouds. Please don't turn away, or my dream will stay hidden out of sight among the lot of might have been. A room with a view and you, and no one to give advice, that sounds a paradise you could fail to choose. With fingers entwined, we find relief from the preachers who always beseech us to mind our P's and Q's. We'll watch the whole world pass before us while we are sitting still, leaning on our own windowsill. We'll build and we'll grow. thought will bring, tis that another day to our room with a view. Mr. Irving Berlin often emphasizes sin in a charming way. Mr. Coward, we know, wrote a song or two to show sex was here to stay. Richard Rogers, it's true, took a more romantic view of this sly biological urge, but it really was Cole who contrived to make the whole thing merge. He said the Belgians and Greeks do it. Nice young men who sell antiques do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. Monkeys, whenever you look, do it. Ali Khan and King Farouk, do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. Luella Parsons can't quite do it. But she's so highly strung. Marlena might do it, but she looks far too young. Each man out there shooting crap does it. Davy Crockett in that dreadful cap does it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. All famous writers in swarms do it. Somerset and all the moms do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. The Brontes felt that they must do it. Ernest Hemingway could just do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. E. Allan Poe, ho, 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 did it. But he did it in verse. H. Beecher Stowe did it. But she had to rehearse. Tennessee Williams, self-taught, does it. Kinsey with a deafening report does it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. In the spring of the year, inhibitions disappear and our hearts beat high. We had better face facts. Every gland that overacts has an alibi. For each bird and each bee, each slap happy sappy tree, each temptation that lures us along is just nature ailment. Merely singing us the same old song. In Texas, some of the men do it. Others drill a hole and then do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. West Point cadets forming fours do it. People say all those gabals do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. My kith and kin, more or less, do it. Every uncle and aunt, that I confess to it. I've one cousin that can't. Teenagers squeezed into jeans do it. Probably will live to see machines do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. Each baby bat after dark does it. In the desert, Wilbur Clark does it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. We're told that every hormone does it. Victor Borger all alone does it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love. Each tiny clam you consume does it. Even Liberace, we assume, does it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
Christopher Marlowe or Francis Bacon? The author of Lear remains unshaken. Willie Herbert or Mary Fitton? What does it matter? The sonnets were written.
Deep in our subconscious, we are told, lie all our memories, lie all the notes of all the music we have ever heard, and all the phrases those we loved have spoken. Sorrows and losses time has since consoled. Family jokes, outmoded anecdotes. Each sentimental souvenir and token, everything seen, experienced, each word addressed to us in infancy, before we could even know or understand the implications of our wonderland. There they all are. The legendary lies, the birthday treats, the sights, the sounds, the tears. Forgotten debris of forgotten years, waiting to be recalled. Waiting to rise before our world dissolves before our eyes. Waiting for some small, intimate reminder, a word, a tune, a known familiar scent, an echo from the past when, innocent, we looked upon the present with delight and doubted not the future would be kinder and never knew the loneliness of night.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to sing you a song that I wrote long ago and far away. The name of it is Mad Dogs and Englishmen. In tropical climes, there are certain times of day when all the citizens retire to tear their clothes off and perspire. You know, it's one of those rules that the greatest fools obey because the sun is far too sultry and one must avoid the buttery violet rain. Pap like a boo, that's natives if you're interested. The natives grieve when the white men leave their huts because they're obviously, definitely nuts. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun, and the Japanese don't care. The Chinese wouldn't dare to. Hindus and Argentines sleep firmly from 12 to 1, but Englishmen detest a siesta. You know, in the Philippines, they have lovely screens to protect you from the glare, and the Malay states their hats like plates, which the Britishers won't wear at 12 noon. The naked swoon, and no further work is done. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun. Oh, it's such a surprise for the Eastern Isles to see that though the English are effete, they're quite impervious to heat. When the white man rides, every native hides in glee, because the simple creatures hope he will impale his soul atopy on the tree. Heaven in house, insane natives, pay no attention. It seems a shame when the English claim the earth that they give rise to such hilarity and mirth. Oh dear. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun. Your smallest Malay rabbit deplores this foolish habit in Hong Kong. They strike a gong and fire off a noonday gun to reprimand each inmate who's in late. In a jungle town where the sun beats down to the rage of man and beast, the English garb of the English Saab merely gets a bit more creased. In Bangkok, at 12 o'clock, they foam at the mouth and run. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out to the midday sun. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun. The toughest Burmese bandit can never understand. The night of the heat of noon is just what the natives shun. They put their scotch or rye down and lie down. In the jungle swamps where the python romps at his peace from 12 till 2, even caribous lie around and snooze with nothing else to do. In Bengal, to move at all is seldom, if ever, done. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out to the midday, 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 out to the midday.
I'm awfully glad we decided not to go out tonight.
Or last night.
Or the night before.
There's absolutely no reason to, and we're so cozy here.
Exactly.
It's as nice, isn't it, Elliot?
Yes, but it's an awfully bad reflection on our characters. I think we ought to be absolutely tortured with conscience.
We are, every now and then.
Darling.
I never realized that you cared for me. I never realized that such a thing and when you went away, then I was sad because, for then I realized what a fool I was.
Oh, darling, you look so sweet in your little dressing gown.
It is pretty ravishing, isn't it?
Do you mind if I come round and kiss you?
A pleasure, Lady Agatha. Not at all. Big romantic stuff, this, darling.
Just make a tune with nothing to mar our joy. I would say such wonderful. sir. Not if it meant having those awful bull's glands popped into me.
Cows for you, you dear, bulls for me.
We certainly live in a marvelous age. Must be so horrible for the poor animals being experimented on.
Not when the experiments are successful. Why, in Vienna, I believe, you can see whole lines of decrepit old rats carrying on like the pillar girls.
Oh, darling.
You remember this one?
What?
When one is lonely, the days are long.
Oh, of course.
Time is so fleet. Why shouldn't we meet? Each night I sing you a lover song. It's incomplete, my sweet.
Cherishing through the perishing winter nights and days a funny little phrase that means such a lot to me that you got to be with me heart and soul, for on you the whole thing leans. Come with me and leave behind the noisy crowd. Sunlight shines for us above the clouds. Please don't turn away, or my dream will stay hidden out of sight among a lot of my loveliness. A room with a view. And no one to worry us, no one to hurry us through this dream we found. We'll gaze at the sky and try to guess what it's all about. Then we will figure out why the world is round. Happy and contented as birds upon a tree, high above the mountains and sea. We'll build and we'll cool, and sorrow will never come, or will it ever come? Give advice that sounds a paradise. You could fail to choose. With fingers entwined, we'll find relief from the preachers who always beseech us to mind a please and cue. We'll watch the whole world pass before us while we are sitting still, leaning on our own will. yourself. We're Bill and we're cool. And maybe a sock will bring this, that and other thing.
What are you doing here?
I'm on my honeymoon.
Very interesting. So am I.
I hope you're enjoying it.
It hasn't started yet.
Neither is mine.
Are you happy?
Perfectly.
Good.
Are you?
Ecstatically.
What's she like?
Hair. Very pretty. Plays the piano beautifully.
Very comforting.
How's yours?
I'd rather not discuss it.
Oh, well, it doesn't matter. You'll probably come popping out in a minute and I shall see for myself.
Have you known her long?
About 4 months. We met on a house party in Norfolk.
Very flat, Norfolk.
There's no need to be unpleasant.
There was no reflection on her, unless, of course, she made it flatter.
Your voice takes on an acid quality every time you mention her.
I swear I'll never mention her again.
Good. Now keep off yours.
Thank you.
Not at all. That orchestra seems to have a remarkably small repertoire.
Strange how potent cheap music is. Someday I'll find you, moonlight behind you, true to the dream I am dreaming. As I draw near you, you smile a little smile, for a little while. We shall stand hand in hand. I'll leave you never, love you forever, all upon sorrow redeeming. Try to make it true, say you need it.
You always had a sweet voice, Amanda.
Thank you.
What exactly were you remembering at that moment?
Lots of things.
So was I.
What fools we would have ruined it all. What utter fools.
We were so ridiculously over in love.
Yes. And yet, here we are starting off with two quite different people. In love all over again, aren't we? Aren't we?
No.
Yes.
We're not in love all over again, and you know it. Good night, Amanda.
Well, you don't leave me. We won't talk about ourselves anymore. Talk about outside things, anything. Stay with me till I pull myself together.
Very well.
What have you been doing lately, during these last years?
I went around the world, you know, after...
Yes, of course I know. How was it?
The world?
Yes.
Very enjoyable.
China must be very interesting.
Very big, China.
And Japan?
Very small.
Did you eat shark fins and take your shoes off and use chopsticks and everything?
Practically everything.
And India? The burning gars or gas or whatever they are, and the Taj Mahal. How was the Taj Mahal?
Unbelievable. A sort of dream.
That was the moonlight, I expect. Of course, you saw it in the moonlight.
Yes. Moonlight can be cruelly deceptive.
And it didn't look like a biscuit box, did it? You know, I've always felt that it might.
Darling, I do love you so.
I do hope you met a sacred elephant. Their limbed white, I believe, is very, very sweet.
I've never loved anybody else for an instant. And you love me too, don't you? There isn't any doubt about it anywhere, is there?
No. No doubt anywhere.
You're looking very lovely in this damned moonlight, Amanda. Your skin is clear and cool, and your eyes are shining. And you're growing lovelier and lovelier every second as I look at you. You don't hold any mystery for me, darling. Do you mind? There isn't a particle of you that I don't know, remember, and want.
Glad my spirit.
More than any desire in the world, deep down in my deepest heart, I want you back again. Please.
Don't say any more. You're making me cry so dreadfully.